The next item of business is consideration of business motion 15071, excuse me, in the name of Jamie Hepburn, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion, therefore the question is that motion 15071 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. Question number one, I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government for what reason it launched a court appeal against a ruling by the Scottish Information Commissioner in light of this costing tens of thousands of pounds and it reportedly receiving legal advice that it was likely to fail.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
The Scottish Government considered there was an important issue of principle in this case which required to be tested. The Court itself agreed that the case raised a sharp and important question of statutory interpretation. The documents recently released by the Scottish Government in relation to this case show that ministers discussed the legal advice with the Lord Advocate, the most senior government legal adviser, who was content that there was proper grounds for appealing and who agreed with ministers that the decision should be appealed. It should be noted that the release of legal advice in this instance does not set a precedent for future cases, and as we have just agreed, the First Minister will be making a statement to this chamber about this matter shortly.
Liam Kerr.
Well, whatever the reason for proceeding, despite the Scottish Government's own Director of Legal Services and Counsel encouraging ministers not to do so, this is a decision in which the Government appears, once again, to have displayed a staggering arrogance and disregard for taxpayer money. Given that the Minister now knows the facts will always come out in the end, can he tell the Chamber exactly how much taxpayer money in total was spent on or by all relevant agencies from the original court decision to today?
Minister.
Well, the amount that has been disbursed in terms of the cost of defending and judicial review are already in the public domain. That's around £118,000. What I would say to the member is that I find it interesting that he describes it as a matter of arrogance to take forward an appeal based on the grounds of the long-standing point of principle that parliamentary legal privilege is normally reserved under these matters. But I've already made the point that the decision was taken forward on the basis of legal advice, and that's something that we determine is important, and that's why we took the case forward.
Liam Kerr.
The publication of the documents reveals that the group set up to support the independent inquiry into Nicola Sturgeon's conduct as First Minister was headed by a Scottish Government civil servant. Now, it's been suggested that the civil servants advising Mr Hamilton in 2021 may have had, let us say, a conflict of interest. In order to clear this up, and accepting that this will all come out sooner or later, can the Minister tell us the name of the seconded civil servant, and if not, whether they still work for the Scottish Government and from what role they were seconded?
Minister.
Well, it wouldn't be appropriate to reveal that name. The support was provided by a career civil servant of seniority below senior service grade, that is, by a junior Scottish Government official. This is something that we need to bear in mind in terms of the information we provide, because we have to adhere to data protection principles, and that's why this individual's name is rightly not going to be made public.
Question number two, Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that Young Enterprise Scotland faces closure due to it withdrawing its support.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well,
Kate
can
Forbes.
I be very clear that funding for Young Enterprise Scotland has not been withdrawn? Since 2022, the Scottish Government has advised Young Enterprise Scotland, along with other stakeholders, that all future entrepreneurial education programmes would be moving to competitive funding. That approach is consistent with other entrepreneurial funds, and indeed it's in the DNA of entrepreneurship. And although Young Enterprise Scotland was not successful in bidding for Entrepreneurial Education Fund because of the strength of other applications, many of whom had previously not received government support, I did this morning meet with the Chair and Chief Executive of Young Enterprise Scotland to update them on the conversations that had already been taking place with officials about additional support, and I have approved the requested £285,000 to run the two programmes that were previously funded by the Scottish Government into it this year. And that will cover expenditure to date for financial year April 24 to March 25. And Young Enterprise Scotland has confirmed that that will ensure the organisation's ongoing viability.
Daniel Johnson.
It's vitally important that we encourage young people to think about entrepreneurialism as a career option, because we know that businesses per head in Scotland, we only have 653 per 10,000 people, compared to UK average of over 1,000. So given that the long-standing success of Young Enterprise Scotland, indeed, I can't be the only one in the chamber to have benefited from Young Enterprise Scotland, given their long-standing success, is it wise to have programmes that put in jeopardy such long-standing success, such as the one that seems to have put Young Enterprise Scotland's future in doubt?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the reason that we have moved to a competitive process is so that all organisations have an equal opportunity to access public funding. What we don't want is to be in a position where some organisations are essentially guaranteed funding and some are guaranteed never to receive funding. When it comes to the Entrepreneurial Education Pathways Fund, we assessed all the applications to that fund. It was assessed by a panel, and we will shortly announce the winners of that fund. But they should give us all confidence and inspiration about the quality of entrepreneurial education that is currently being delivered across Scotland. And I'm hugely excited about the fact that many of those organisations have never received funding before.
Daniel Johnson.
So if we're to believe that this is a decision being made on effectiveness and outcomes, given that Young Enterprise Scotland reached 18,000 young people a year and over 1,000 people gained qualifications through Young Enterprise Scotland per year, can she state how many young people will be in contact with the future programmes and how many qualifications will be able to be achieved by young people through these future programmes of work that the Cabinet Secretary has so much confidence in?
Well, actually, I can go further, and obviously I'm not in a position today to announce all of the winners, because that is rightly for another date. But for the first time ever, we will be in a position to deliver programmes from Primary 1 through to S6, providing an end-to-end pathway for developing an entrepreneurial mindset. This government is extremely proud of the changes that we have made to entrepreneurship in Scotland to ensure that there is a pathway for entrepreneurial activity. And the reason why we moved to a competitive bid is to ensure that that provision was effective, it was efficient, it was impactful, and it was fair to organisations that previously felt excluded because of the way the funding was set up.
Owen Beattie.
Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Entrepreneurial Education Pathways Fund will help encourage more young people from a wide range of backgrounds to choose business ownership as a career path and establish a culture in Scotland that encourages, promotes and celebrates entrepreneurial learning from an early age?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, including the fund that Colin Beattie just referenced, we're investing £1.7 million in entrepreneurial education this year. And that will mean supporting highly innovative organisations, many of whom have not received government funding in the past. And this approach, in my view, is fair. It drives impact for public investment, and it reflects our ambition to support the next generation of business leaders with the best possible tools and resources. And I hope that when we announce the winners of that fund, colleagues from across different parties will be equally enthused and inspired by what some of these organisations have done, many in sort of behind the scenes for a number of years.